I'd like to point out that we are all children of the true God, not the imaginary God that we've imagined, thinking that is advocating that lack of freedom, that our freedom, we've lost our freedom, and that we're bound to time and space and form. That's an imaginary God. We're all children of the true God, and as such, we are free. I am not a body, I am free. I am as God created me. Now, why are we having such a problem? I have an even clearer explanation of this now for you. So if we can just gather our nerves here. Humbly expecting breakthroughs. Essentially, the disagreement in this world is like this. The people of the world, they say, obviously we're not free, because if we were free, they say, the very next moment we would certainly choose to set this dream of fear and death and failure down. And since we're not setting it down, that proves, they say, this proves we're not free. Okay. Now this, you know, like stuns us, say, whoa. They're right, and they say, hey, if you're free, then like Jesus on the cross, they say, hey, you're free, choose to save yourself, right? And they say to us, if you're free, then drop this dream right now. Drop this dream right now. And they say, aha, you didn't do it, did you? That proves you're not free. Okay, this is the ideology driving this world. Now I'm going to point out to you the obvious rebuttal to this, obvious but all important. I say to them, I say no, it proves no such thing. What it proves is that I have a severe continuity problem, and I'm afraid to choose in the next moment to not have this failure scenario, a limitation of freedom being hypothetically presented. I'm afraid to not have that the next moment. So I'm in my freedom, I am choosing the next moment to be similar to the previous moment, out of a continuity fear. That's the real problem. Not that my freedom is limited or I've lost my freedom. My freedom is still perfect. But I'm using my freedom to choose a moment that is similar to this one out of a continuity fear, severe continuity fear. Because if I chose to drop the dream like that the next moment, I'm afraid I wouldn't know how to function in this pure freedom, pure happiness, timeless, spaceless, you know, instantaneous, all-knowing flow of reality. I'm afraid that it's so dissimilar to what I have been experiencing for so long. I'm afraid to choose the next moment to be different. That's the real problem. So this is the rebuttal to the world. It's all-important rebuttal. How to rebut the world, what they're saying. The world says that the very fact that this continues and you continue on with it proves you are not free. And I say it proves no such thing. It proves I have a continuity problem. So when I say that admitting, accepting that you have a continuity problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have any other problem. I only have a continuity problem. This literally frees you from this incredibly terrible dynamic of this world, which seems to prove that we've lost our freedom, that we don't have it anymore. And if that were the case, then the only thing we can do is to try and solve the quote-unquote problems of this world, which are infinite and never ending. And so that's how you get hooked into trying to make the world a better place, trying to solve the problems of the world, because we believe we've lost our freedom, because we seem to have the proof all around us. We say, wow, yeah, it's automatic. I can't choose to drop this dream. It keeps going on and on and on. So this must be the new reality. Therefore, I've got to learn to be happy within this new reality of impermanence, of death, of conflict, of perception, of time, of space, of location, of relativism, of dualism. Everything that arises, conflicts arise from this, which is ceaseless. I'm supposed to work on those problems. That seems to be the only option I have. And what we're saying, we're rebutting that entirely with the continuity practice. We're saying, no, I do not have any of those problems. I only have a continuity problem because I'm free. I am as God created me. I'm not a body, I'm free, I am as God created me. I only have a continuity problem. My freedom is still perfect. I'm simply exercising it to choose that this next moment, this moment right here, is similar to the one previously. And the world says, no, if you were free, you would choose differently, because this world is full of suffering and misery and unhappiness. So if you were free, for sure, you'd choose to drop that. And I say, no, that's not true. Because of the continuity fear, we would not choose to drop it. We would choose to have a moment quite similar until we resolve the continuity fear. And then we would choose a moment that is much superior. Vision of oneness, we would choose the vision of oneness once we work through enough of this continuity fear. So you see, there is a radical crossroads divergence between ideologies on this planet. Those who believe that freedom has, we've lost our unlimited freedom and somehow it's been limited, and those who insist we have not lost it, we simply have a continuity problem. Those two ways are utterly divergent. Because one insists that we are stuck with all the problems of the world and we have to find a way to quote-unquote fix them or compromise or get along with them or adjust to these problems. The other says, no, we don't have to fix or adjust to anything. We simply have to be willing to exercise, resolve the continuity problem, and then we'll be willing to exercise our freedom, and we will at some point choose a moment that is free of the insane belief in time, space, and bodies and form. Completely divergent ideologies, right? So this lunatic idea that somehow we can all get on the same page is preposterous, unless that page was everyone realizing they have a continuity problem. But that's, you know, that could be a long way off. Eventually everyone will realize that. In time and space, though, it can be seen to be stretched out, you know, immeasurably. So it is the ego that floats this compromise issue, because the ego says, well, you know, it's buying time. It's buying time to figure out, you know, how do we deal with this, what they think is our insanity. How can we get rid of this insanity is what they're thinking of. See, these people, the ego says, these people, they still think they're free. Obviously, they're nuts, because they're refusing to accept all the evidence we have, which is overwhelming. So these are people incapable of accepting overwhelming evidence. They lack reason, is what the ego, how the ego sees it. So the ego is trying to figure out how to really annihilate us, is what it is. As it says, well, let's compromise on this. How can you compromise? Either we're free or we're not. It's one or the other. There isn't any third option. We're either free or we're not. If we're free, then we have a continuity problem. If we're not, then we have to work on solving all these problems. You know, that has to be our effort. Problems of existence, so we can adapt to this situation. Believe that we're a body and that we need to, you know, keep functioning as if that were true, and solve all the problems from that standpoint. So there's a total impasse. It's a total impasse there. And so you simply have to stand on what you know is true. And again, all this so-called overwhelming evidence that we have is all manufactured evidence. It's all arising each moment, contains all this evidence in that moment. It doesn't spill over to the next moment. So each moment is a picture of what we want to see. We want to see evidence that we're not free because we're trying to limit our freedom. But we're entirely free the next moment to not see that evidence. You see what I'm saying here? So in each moment, there's a massive amount of evidence, but that does not bind the next moment. One moment, please. All right. So we can talk about this. It's not too tricky to talk about, actually. And we don't need to struggle with it. It's better to reduce it to its very basic elements and to say the reason I don't choose to be free of all the suffering and misery in the very next moment is because I have a continuity problem, and I'm afraid of pure happiness. I'm afraid to experience it. And just make that admission. And then I know I can make it because I know I have techniques to work on that. Whereas the ego says, well, if you're afraid of pure happiness, then you're really in bad shape. You can never go back home, can you? I say, oh, yes, I can, because I have ways to reduce the fear. That's what spiritual practice is all about, is reducing the fear of our true freedom, our true happiness, reducing the fear of that. And gradually moving our comfort zone towards that. That's what right spiritual practice is all about. And the ego, since the ego says, well, no, you're not free. You've lost your freedom. Doing these spiritual practices to the ego is insanity. So the ego cannot change its position. The position that we've limited our freedom is an insane position inherently. It cannot change its insanity. You cannot believe that we've limited our freedom without having an insane belief system. It's impossible. The ego is the voice of the insane belief system. So it will always speak of insanity. The ego always will. You cannot change it. The Holy Spirit is the voice of sanity, which says we cannot limit our freedom. And so the Holy Spirit will always be sane. The ego will always be insane. The Holy Spirit will always be sane. That's how it is. There's no compromise there. You know, you either listen to insanity or you listen to sanity. There isn't some third option. But the Holy Spirit recognizes the continuity problem and says, gently move your comfort zone. Do practice it. Practice. Listen. Think. Contemplate. Be still. Be quiet. Be calm. Be non-reactive, non-argumentative. So we simply have a choice of which way to go. That's all. The ego says, well, now you have the option to think about it a little longer. Now we're either listening to one voice or the other. There isn't like any situation where we're not contemplating, not thinking at all which way to go. Because there is no vacuum like that. There is no vacuum. So either we're leaning towards one way or leaning towards the other way, going one way or the other way. Whatever time we give the ego is taken away from the Holy Spirit. Whatever time we give to the Holy Spirit is taken away from the ego. That's the situation. And the ego, of course, is desperate to keep us from listening to the Holy Spirit, thinking that the Holy Spirit is completely insane. Which is, it's really its own fear that it's actually completely insane. And it doesn't want us to recognize that. Which is really our own fear, continuity fear, of falling into the abyss. But once we recognize we have this continuity fear, then the ego, we don't really listen to it so much anymore. It doesn't press us like it used to. It's a big relief. Big relief. Because it's really an expression of our own fear. The ego is just an expression of our own fear, really. And when our fear is diminished, there's less expression of that fear, less pressure on us. And then we can turn more and more to the Holy Spirit. So the root turnaround is on this continuity issue. As all this evidence that arises in this moment, is that evidence we've lost our freedom? The fact that we've chosen this moment like this? Or is it evidence that we have a continuity fear? This is the question. It can't be both. It's either one or the other. Either we've lost our freedom or we haven't. And if we haven't, then for sure, this is an expression of continuity fear, for sure. And if we have lost our freedom, then it's not an expression of continuity fear. It's an expression of resistance and laziness to adjust to the new reality of you know, lack of freedom. So it's one or the other. Let's not play games here and think that there's some other option. It's one or the other. So we can push back. But this idea that the world is headed towards some great synthesis is insanity. There is no synthesis between truth and lies. There is no synthesis between the belief we've limited our freedom and therefore lost it, actually. Limited freedom is lost freedom. Between that and true freedom, we haven't limited it. There is no synthesis. Okay, the ego promotes this idea of synthesis. And if you don't go along with it, it claims that you are a troglodyte, you know, that you're failing to see the potential, the, you know, human potential movement. You're failing to see the potential. There's no potential there. No potential. They say you're radical. You're claiming that you got to choose one or the other. Yeah, you have to choose, either have a continuity problem or you don't. Either truth is true or it isn't. Or lies are true. You know, Either, you know, it's either we've limited our freedom or we haven't. There isn't any third option. But make no mistake. The ego is virulently, pursuing its objective, which is to denounce those who refuse to accept the evidence, claiming that's a sign of insanity on their part, incapacity to be logical and reasonable. The ego will say, look, you're being totally unreasonable. Everyone is choosing, here on the planet, is choosing the next moment to be similar to the previous one, and all this misery, decay, impermanence, death, all these cycles, the whole universe, everything continues to function. So it must be just an automaton. It has to be an automaton, they say. It's happening by itself. We're not the cause of it at all. Our imagining can't be the cause of it. And therefore, we're simply, this is reality, this is, and our bodies are our identity, we're here, we have to adapt to this and accept this. And if anyone who fails to do that must be completely insane, and has to be treated. This is the ego standpoint, always will be. Always will be. Now, we counter that many different ways. And we know that there have been beings here in this world who chose differently and showed us it is all a dream, and you can choose the next moment to be different than the one before, and to be free of fear, doubt, confusion, depression, sickness, ugliness, filth, death, decay. You can choose to see everything as utterly blissful and beautiful. You can choose to see the vision of oneness. There have been quite a few beings come into this world who demonstrated that to us, totally falsifying the ego's claims, okay? Totally. Now, of course, the ego just ignores that, as you would expect. What else can the ego do? It's the voice of our fear. It's the voice of our continuity fear. So, of course, it will ignore the evidence. It has no interest in any evidence that points out that it's mistaken. No interest. It only keeps insisting that you stay away from that because it's dangerous. It'll drive you crazy. They said it's going to make you crazy. No, it will point out that the ego's insane, is what it will do. And so, of course, people say, there's no evidence. That's because the people have been listening to the ego and not paying attention to the evidence. And the ego will never lead you to the evidence. It will dispute, it will twist, it will distort. It will claim you're crazy. You're going to go crazy if you study this, if you pay attention to this. Not true, not true, not true. All lies. But we do have a severe continuity problem. So once we recognize that's what the problem is, then we'll go easy, we'll go careful, we'll go cautious, we'll still pay attention to truth, the witnesses to truth, but in a intelligent way, saying, hey, I know I have a severe continuity problem. So when I tend to retreat, I know that's the continuity problem speaking, jitters, I'm getting jitters. Let it calm down, and then I'll regather my nerve and I'll go back again. That's the spiritual path. Spiritual path is two steps forward, one step back. You go forward, then you get the jitters. Say, whoa, wait a minute, maybe I'm going too fast. Then you kind of take a half step, take a step back. Then you take two steps forward, and then a step back, two steps forward. Like that. That's how it goes. And you can do it once you recognize that your real problem is the continuity problem. Then you are kind to yourself. And you say, okay, I understand that I'm going to backslide a little bit, but let's just minimize the backsliding. One way to do it is minimize the amount of time you spend. Don't get dismayed. In other words, if you get dismayed, you're angry, all the stuff that prolongs it. Just say, okay, let me just keep my stride going best as possible here. Let me regather my nerve, take a little rest, a little time out, regather my nerve. Don't struggle with it. It's just a symptom. It's evidence of a continuity issue. It is not evidence that my freedom has been limited and that I'll fall into an abyss. It is not evidence of that whatsoever. The ego says, you'll fall into an abyss, you'll fall into an abyss. What it really means is you'll find yourself floating, totally supported by pure happiness. You'll find yourself completely saturated and supported. And the ego claims that's an abyss. It's not, it's the opposite of an abyss. It's abyss-free. Abyss-free happiness. Abyss-free pure happiness. Totally unaffected by any definition, including the definition of an abyss. Totally unaffected by that. So we understand why the dark night of the soul arises on the spiritual path. It can be very difficult because you seem to be always going into a headwind, you know, always climbing uphill, always going uphill. It seems like, wow, it's the continuity fear is the hill that you're climbing. Gradually the mountain gets less and less and less and less, you know, the steepness of the mountain gets less and less and less. And as it does, you'll find yourself being able to go along much quicker, much quicker, much quicker, much quicker. Eventually, the slope will actually go down and you're just coasting. When the vision of oneness is just coasting, from that point on, you're just coasting. No more effort is required. And of course, we're so used to effort that in itself is frightening. Like, wow, what do you mean no more effort? I need effort, I'm used to effort. That's the mountain of the continuity fear. So we practice in ways that rehearse the effortlessness of it, the coasting. We're just coasting now, no effort. Okay, to reiterate then, this very important clarity. We've been able to see there's this fundamental disagreement in the world. Fundamental disagreement. The ego tries to blur how fundamental it is because it doesn't want you to see what the choice is. So it all throws up these smoke screens of compromise and blah, 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 blah. It doesn't want you to see how fundamental the conflict is, the divergence is. It is fundamental. Our continuity fear, we want to obscure it. We say, I don't want to choose, I'm too frightened. But remember, we're choosing a direction, okay, a path. Because it takes a while to overcome this continuity fear, to evaporate it away. It takes a while, quite a while, actually. So it's not going to just evaporate for you instantly. Not a severe continuity fear. If you've already worked on it to a large extent, then it can evaporate quickly. I had a dream last night where I was immersed in these floodwaters, and I thought I was really stuck. I said, okay, I can't figure out any way to solve this. And suddenly I figured out the way. And all the floodwaters disappeared in an instant. In one instant, all whoosh, gone. I was just like, wow, what just happened? They're all, it wasn't like going down a drain, you know, slowly going down a drain. It was like they were sucked down a drain, the floodwaters, instantly, which is obviously miraculous, right? Because ordinarily volume, it takes time to go down a drain, right? Physics. Well, this transcended physics. All the water went down the drain instantly. Because it's all just symbols, all just images, right? And therefore, there's nothing stopping you from seeing the image of it all going down the drain instantly, actually. And all that was left in the room was just little traces of moisture. I see. Just to let me know that something did happen. So I wasn't like the room was completely dry. There was a little bit of moisture on the base and the walls, just a little tiny drop here, and a little trace of moisture here and there. And I said, oh yeah. So I still had the feeling that there had been moisture in the room, right? It was very little though. A lot of the room was dry. So I wasn't completely devoid of any evidence that the moisture had been there, see? But the water was gone. It was gone instantaneously. Very profound dream, which means I'm really there on the cusp of this, really there, understanding the situation. And I accepted it. I said, that's really cool. That's really cool. I like that. Yeah, so fast, you know, liberated so fast like that. But this won't happen until you have taken the path of gradually evaporating your continuity fear. It won't happen until you've done that. So don't be afraid. Don't let the ego deceive you. Because the ego says, prove to me that you're free. Choose the next moment to be entirely unlike this one. And you say, no, that's not any proof. I don't need to prove anything to you. I have a severe continuity fear, so I'm going to choose the next instant to be quite similar to this one out of honoring my continuity fear, which is really honoring our creative ability. When we honor our continuity fear, we're honoring our creative ability to create a scenario so opposite to reality that it has enmeshed us for so long that we develop this continuity fear. So we're really acknowledging our creative capacity. So don't let the ego trick you in that way. And you don't have to choose a moment that's totally dissimilar to this one. You can choose one very similar. And gradually, you work on the continuity fear. So don't be afraid to stand up to the ego and its complete insanity. Saying, look at all this evidence. I say, it's only evidence of a continuity fear. This is the hinge. This is the turning point in your life, in your existence, in your salvation. Say, no, ego, it's only evidence I have a severe continuity fear. Once you make that admission and you say, yeah, okay, this is what I'm going to believe in and work on, you are truly on the road to salvation from this insane belief that we can limit our freedom. We've never limited our freedom. Our freedom is not limited. Our happiness is still completely pure. And there have been beings on this planet who have showed that to us, who showcased that to us. Absolutely they have. But we have to do it now. We cannot just say, well, they did it, let's just worship them, everything will be fine. We have to do it right now. Here we are. The ego is lying to us like crazy right now. We have to rebut it. It's up to us to rebut it. Those teachers and those examples in the past who gave us the true evidence that can be helpful to keep reassuring us, but we have to, in our own mind, rebut the ego in our own mind, you see. In the mind, in our continuity fear, we have to accept, we have to work this out. We have to evaporate it. And not outsmart ourselves, which the ego tries to get us to do. It tries to play on words and concepts and plausibilities and proof and all this stuff. You just say, no, I don't have any of those problems. I don't have a proof problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a plausibility problem. I have a continuity problem. All of this, I don't have an evidence problem. I have a continuity problem. Just refuse to accept the framework that the ego is trying to put the situation, put around the situation. Refuse to accept that. Say, no. No. I know all I have is a continuity problem. That's it. There is no other problem. Again, why do we choose to keep on suffering? Continuity problem. It's not evidence that we're not free. Even people die and you think, wow, you hear about people changing their beliefs at the moment of death. I haven't seen that happen. And they don't. Why? Continuity problem. Continuity problem. They say, no, I want this next moment to be similar to the others. I don't want to invalidate an entire lifetime of believing that I had to age and get old and get sick and then die. I'm too scared of invalidating that. And so I'm going to continue with my death and make each moment, you know, and continue on with it. Yeah. So we continue with our suffering, our misery, our poverty, our scarcity, our fear, unhappiness, sickness, aging, confusion, depression, anxiety. We continue with all of that. but it's still an expression of our freedom. Even though we're suffering, we don't like it, we feel the alternative is an abyss. So of course, this is preferable to an abyss. Anything's preferable to an abyss. Even our death is preferable to an abyss. But there is no abyss. Okay? We have a continuity fear. Not an abyss, we have a continuity fear. And it's manageable, and it's correctable, and it's evaporatable. This is what the spiritual path is all about. This is what the ego is trying to get rid of. It's trying to get rid of the spiritual path and instead replacing it with pop spirituality. It says, you don't need a path. All you need is this little fast food, pop spirituality. Like, be kind to all sentient beings. That's it. Don't need anything more. Be compassionate. Okay, I got it. I have a compassionate life. Great. Do something kind to someone sometime. Okay. So, you know, they go along and say, you know, Hi, how are you? I'm kind to you. Good. That's it. I've done enough. That's enough for a lifetime. I was kind to somebody. The ego wants to get rid of spiritual vocation, spiritual path. In other words, doesn't want people spending a lifetime focusing on the continuity problem because it knows that's what's going to work, and the ego's toast if you do that. It wants to get rid of all of that and have some bland, watered-down teaching that doesn't get you truly get the work done of evaporating the continuity problem, continuity fear. There's a massive fear there, a mountain of fear, and we have to work at evaporating this mountain of fear, and it takes a while. There's no question about it. It takes a while. I spent a lifetime working on it. And all the great teachers have said it needs to be your vocation in life. It needs to be your true passion, your true career. You can have a livelihood, sure, but your true career is the spiritual path. Has to be. And the ego is at war with this. Is at war with this. This is the fundamental war that's taking place. It's an ideological war in the world. And it says that's insane. It's a proof that you're insane because you're wasting your time. You're not getting with the world agenda, the world program, we're building the golden age, you know, solving all the world's problems here by technology. The ego insists that you drop all of that. Defund. It wants to defund it all entirely. It wants to stigmatize it, defund it, exterminate it from the world. So you won't have a spiritual path. You'll have a slogan, maybe. Not even that, actually. There you go. You're too busy solving the world's problems to focus on that, right? Now, this is a serious situation as far as delay is concerned right now. So that's why I'm putting all my efforts to try and help, because I know delay is just delay. Doubling down on delay is just doubling down on delay. That's all it is. Just more delay. More delay. We have no choice but to set down the insane, whimsical idea that we can limit our freedom. We have no choice but to set that down. At some point, we have to. What's preventing that is the continuity fear. So we have to work on our continuity fear. And in order to work on it, we have to work on it quite diligently. Otherwise, we'll backslide too much. In other words, we have to give the preponderance of our attention to the Holy Spirit, to truth, the voice of truth within us, and limit the voice of the ego with listening to that. Limit the time we spend listening to the ego. If you give the ego more time than the Holy Spirit, then you know, the ego is going to make a lot of, it's going to undermine your resolve, your momentum, your progress, and you'll feel very upset and frightened and fearful and thinking, wow, this path doesn't work. It's fraud, it's folly. You know, maybe the ego's right. And you'll panic. It'll cause panic on you and you'll feel very anxious and worried. When you give more attention to the Holy Spirit, you will find that all these anxieties tend to dry up. And you don't feel that it's too difficult. You don't have these jagged discontinuities, like, wow, swinging back from one side to the other. All this very erraticness is smoother. It's smoother. It's not entirely smooth, but it is smoother. And your stride becomes smoother and smoother. And you say, yeah, I get it, I get it, I get it, I get it, I get it. Ego, not, you're lying, you're lying, you're lying. I'm not interested in what you have to say. And it smooths out for you. So if we want to help the world, we need to place the utmost emphasis and support and respect upon spiritual vocations of all types, of meditation, of life and contemplation, meditation, study, prayer. This should be the highest ideal upheld by society on all levels. It has to be. No way around it. Eventually, everyone will have to dwell in such a world, a society that does adore, cherish, with utmost devotion, this ideal of lifetime of effort. The highest good. This is what works. This is what truly brings peace. This is the way. Everyone has to find themselves in such a situation. Or swim against the current like I'm doing here now because out of necessity, which is quite difficult actually. So they either have to do that or be in a more supportive world that supports a spiritual vocation. One of the two, because the continuity fear has to be evaporated, so we set down this insane idea that we can limit our freedom. We have no choice about that whatsoever, none. So if we don't do it, it's simply delay. Just a simple delay, and that's all it is. There isn't anything else attached to that. It's just delay. Wasted time. Frivolous time spent doing nothing. Now, of course, there's a period where you're upset because you think, I've worked so hard to solve the problems of the world, and now I feel like an amateur trying to deal with this continuity fear. I feel like I'm starting like a child. This is terrible. I'm a very respected person. I've had so much success in the world. This is crazy. Why should I have to struggle so hard? It's not right. And you get very indignant and upset about this. Very, very humbling. Very humbling. But that again is an expression of our creativity, that we're able to deceive ourselves so severely and get ourselves going along with this ludicrous idea that somehow magically, if we just keep working on believing that we're not free, that it'll become true. And we just think we need to give it more time, more effort, come on, just wait it out. As we wait it out, we develop a severe continuity problem. So it's like, wow, but it's an expression of our creativity, actually. So we need to accept it that way and honor ourselves by saying, wow, okay, I do need to get this done now. And as I do it, I'm not dishonoring myself. This is honorable to work on this. So it has to be seen as the honorable, respectful, right thing to do in existence, period. And delay is folly. Just folly. Silly folly. Whimsical. There's whimsicality is all it is. So you might say this world has become extraordinarily whimsical. That's how I view it. It is a preposterously whimsical world at this time. Becoming all the more so. The more whimsical it becomes exponential, right? As you cave into whimsicality, it becomes exponential and then unmeasurable, because what do you measure about whimsicality? Is completely erratic. There's, you know, it's like chaotic, really. In terms of truth, it's just whimsical. You'll accept one thing and say, no, it's not that. And there's no such thing as facts to whimsicality. No such thing. It's completely presumptuous and arrogant about, and whimsical about, well, I like this fact now, and then, well, today it's a fact, tomorrow it's not a fact. Where's the sanity there? There isn't any. So you might say the world is becoming whimsically insane. And the answer is, we don't need to worry about any continuity problem. We're going to change reality, and we're already adapted to that change reality, so we're fine. We're fine. Again, madness. So the root again of the possibly be free. Because by our own omissions, this is suffering and misery. So if we were free, we'd choose differently. So the fact that we don't proves we're not free. That is the ego's whole basic argument right there. And we say it proves no such thing. It only proves our creativity and bringing about a severe continuity problem. That's all that it proves. That's what it proves. So those two sides, choose which one you want. There's not a third side. The ego tells you that there's some third side, you're just not seeing it, you're not seeing it. No. You're afraid to realize there's only two sides, you have to choose one or the other. And in choosing that I have a continuity problem, that means I get to work on that problem. I have a continuity fear, it means I need to work on evaporating that fear gradually. So it's not a sudden thing. There's no abyss anywhere. There's no abyss. So I'm just seeing if I can get something, some more help out here somehow. Now, of course, if there's no vocation, no support for a spiritual path in the world, it tends to intensify the continuity fear, because you say, whoa, if I start on this path, no one's going to support me, and it's going to be too difficult for me, you know, then I'll really be in trouble, because I'm not adapted to the, you know, to the circumstances that the ego is presenting in the world. I won't be ill-suited, ill-adapted to it. So that is an issue. It is an issue. And how to resolve that issue is a question that I still don't have the answer to that. I didn't have real support, actually, but I there was enough momentum from previous ages in this world spilling over where I felt somehow empowered to take the path. I could easily see people in situations where they feel there's simply no support whatsoever. And I did the whole path quietly without saying I was even on the path. Didn't tell anybody about it. Because they wouldn't have been supportive, for sure. For sure. So I know, understand, having to take the path in a non-supportive environment. That's what I've done. But I was able to get started on it because there was a current of support, small current of support coming from the evidence of previous beings here in the world and exposure to that evidence at an early age, and plus my acceptance of it and all that. So it is possible for the environment to be so non-supportive that people will simply feel like they can't get started. I mean, I can see that. I can see it. I can see the whole world becoming that way, actually. What happens then? What happens is a lot of people want to leave the world, is what happens. And, you know, I have to honor that, too. I have to get to a place where I can honor that. I can say, hey, I can help you. But they say, look, overall, I don't feel enough support in this world to actually take the spiritual path. I want to go somewhere else where there is more support. And so I have to accept and honor that. You know, it seems like a slap in the face to me, saying, well, what do you mean? I can help you. Well, it may not be enough help, you know, for most people, really, because they really need quite a current of help here, quite a current of help. Now, I tried to bring to the attention of the world the various great beings who have shown us that the problem we have is a continuity problem and not that our freedom is limited, who have proved this to us and proved the ego's a liar. But people were not interested. I spent enormous effort trying to bring that to people's attention. Nobody cared. Nobody cared. They just said, oh yeah, they're a nice person, beautiful person, they're not nice. But they didn't really realize, you know, how to use this evidence. It's evidence. It refutes the ego entirely. But I got it. When I saw the evidence, I said, wow, That totally refutes the ego, totally. And then I got to work, just got to work intensely. I said, wow, all I gotta do is evaporate the continuity fear and I'm going to be free. I'm going to realize my freedom. I'm going to realize it and use it. Use it to choose a moment different than this one, where I'm happy, you know. So, you have to use the evidence. Where I don't see people using it. I don't. They say, oh yeah, oh, that's a beautiful person, nice person, really, really nice. Okay. They're too afraid, you know, I think, too afraid in a lot of levels. Maybe at some level they're using it, possible, but I'm not aware of that helping very much. So it could very well be that there will be a lot of people who simply in their spirit will say, you know what, I can't make it here. It's too tough. Well, okay, I have to kind of, you know, let that go. I have to let it go. That's my challenge, let it go. It's not a knock on me. It's just a pragmatic situation that overall this planet has become too difficult for people to start a path. It could very well be the case, very well be the case. So I'm having to, you know, accept that. It's kind of very humbling. Because just, you know, just one person, two people said, you know, again, it's honoring our creativity. Our creativity can make it seem extremely difficult and even reject the evidence that is given. It can. Ultimately, though, we have no choice. Ultimately, we have no choice, and ultimately, everyone feels that. But it seems that there's been a collective will here on this planet to decide to double down on deceit, self-deceit, to double down on it and say, hey, look, we can make things so nice here on this planet with technology, we don't even have to worry about the fact that we've lost our freedom, the false fact that we've lost our freedom. We don't have to worry about any continuity fear. We'll stay right here. And we'll just, you know, call it good. And so people are just kind of saying, oh, okay, that seems easier. Quicker, simpler, easier, right? It's a seduction of spirit is what it is. And, you know, the will on the planet seems to be, that's what people are going for now. And being educated into and saying, you know, forget about the spiritual path, you don't need it. That yeah, we did lose our freedom, but it's okay because we have this new reality and we'll be able to be happy here. See, that's what they're saying. At some point they'll realize their mistake. It may not be now, but there could be a lot of people on the planet again saying, wow, we can't make it here. All we see here is delay. So we want to leave. We want to leave. And many may leave through the death of their bodies. That is quite possible. Now, I was told, don't keep trying to bring the saints of the past to the attention of the world. The world's not interested. You're wasting your time. It's not going to work. And I've tried my utmost. It didn't work. An amazing amount of effort, actually, that people don't even know about. Money, time, and effort. I put my whole heart and soul into it. It didn't work. And I was told, don't keep trying that because you're only going to cause your own progress to fall apart because you'll be so upset and distraught at your failure. Honor the creativity. Honor the creativity by saying, yeah, it is possible for an entire planet to go bad for a time. Yes, it is. And it is possible that many people will say, look, I don't care if you're liberated or not. It's not enough. It's too overwhelming for me. I want to leave. And you got to say, okay, you know. And don't take it as a rejection, you know, of truth that they say, no, you're lying. Just say this. I just feel it's going to be too tough to take the spiritual path under these circumstances. That's very possible. So I was told, do not try to help people by, you know, bringing to light various liberated beings in the past. Don't do that anymore. Don't do it. You'll get yourself in a lot of trouble because it's not being taken in the right way. They'll be taken as figureheads to empower, trying to make this world a better place, is what it's will be taken as. And this, you know, just the ego will co-opt it. And there isn't will on this planet to say no to that. There isn't the will there. So, and since that point where I refused to do that, I said, no, okay, I stopped doing it. I've realized, wow, I've seen all the traps, so many traps that have been set in this world now that I would have fallen into. And I say, oh my God, I would have fallen into that trap. I would have fallen into this one. I would have fallen into that one. So it's entirely possible many people will choose to leave this world soon. And go to another world, another dwelling place, where there's support for the spiritual path. And then get it done. Get it done. It can be done in one lifetime. For sure. For sure. Absolutely. When you dedicate yourself to it, you can do it in one lifetime or less than one lifetime, you can do it. It can be done. For sure. And there are many, many dwelling places, actually. This world is not the only dwelling place there is. Many, 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 many dwelling places. However you want to describe them, whether it's some other quote-unquote dimension, or in this dimension, etc. Many dwelling places. Now the question is, after this end times conflict and problems, etc., will this world decide to host, you know, spiritual path once again? Will it decide? Possible. That's possible? Sure. Why not? It's not trending in that direction right now, to say the least. A lot would have to change. That'd be dramatic, incredible shift and changes for that to happen. But it's possible? Sure. It's also possible that it won't. Oh. But the fact that maybe people will not be helped by what I have to offer in no way gives any evidence that we're not free. It only gives evidence of the severity of the continuity problem. That's all that it does. And it doesn't, I can't let it discourage me, because I know there's a way to deal with the continuity problem and evaporate it if people simply feel able to summon their will to practice. Here on this planet, it's extremely difficult for people to summon their will. This is what I've discovered. They can only talk about it, they can't do it. That's the problem, because they're too afraid that they might have some success and the world will reject them. You see, and this threat of an abyss, a threat of loss of status, a threat of being having a continuity problem, of trying to fit into the world and function here in the world, all that is so severe, and be sure people will do a little meditation, they'll do a little yoga, they'll do a little this, that's about it right now, that's about it. They'll do some Ayurvedic healing, they'll do some crystals, they'll do some toning, they'll do some chanting. They'll do some dancing, they'll do some breathing exercises, they'll sit beside a peaceful lake, you know, all this stuff. Sure, they'll do all that stuff. That's about it. They won't actually practice, direct practice, what needs to be done, what actually works. They won't do that. So they will not feel the rapid type of momentum. The great teachers tell us along the path, your momentum has to be, your progress has to be rapid. Otherwise, you'll easily get discouraged. So someone will say, yeah, I went to a retreat and it was relaxing, it was nice. When was that? Oh, it was like about, I don't know, about 10 years ago or something I did that. It was really nice. I'd like to do it again sometime. That doesn't get the job done. Question is, how many hours have you of intense effort have you put in today? How much did I put in yesterday? Well, I put in maybe yesterday, maybe 8 to 10 hours of intense effort. Today, I've put in already about 4 hours of intense effort, you see. I'm not keeping track, but it's just ballpark figures, you know. In fact, I put in every day is a full day of effort for me in one way or the other. Every day, every single day. Of course, does anyone support that? No, no, I don't tell anyone about it. They wouldn't be supportive of it, no way. They'd say, wow, what a huge waste of time you're engaged in. Massive waste of time. Not true, because I've gotten to the root of the problem. The root of the ego's lie is the claim that the fact that I'm choosing to see the world almost exactly the same as it was the last moment, the picture, this moment, the picture is the same as the last moment, in no way means that moments are joined and moments affect one another. The past determines the future, which would mean we're not free. In no way does it mean that. It simply means I have a severe continuity problem. See, I'm accepting this, I'm declaring, I'm accepting this as true. That is a gigantic, this is the essential realization, gigantic essential realization. So I've been able to get to that, which means I haven't been wasting my time. Now, when I came into the world, people insisted I was audacious, said, you're overly audacious. Your goals are unreachable. That's what I was told. I said, no, I'm going to be liberated this lifetime. I am going to be liberated. And they said, no, only the great ones are liberated. I said, well, I'm going to do it. And they said, you're totally too audacious. We can't go with that. Your goals are too high. See, lack of support. In a supportive society, people would say, great, we'll support you all the way with this. Get working, let's get working. Totally excellent. So happy you're here. That's the kind of determination we're looking for. But here, this world said, you're off your rocker. You're just dreaming. You're just imagining. You can't do that. No way. You know, only Buddha could do that. They'd say, or only, you know, Jesus could do that. Or only, who do you think you are? And I said, what do you mean? And I says, everyone has to do it. So I'm going to do it. And I didn't get the support. They said, read these books here. Maybe you'll decide it's too tough for you. I think a lot of the spiritual books people gave me were a way to convince me it was too difficult. Maybe there was some help there too. They said, you know, well, I don't know if you can or not. You know, maybe some people said like, well, you know, it's unlikely you will, but I hope you do. So maybe there was some of that too. But there was probably also a lot of, you know, you just see how difficult it is and you'll give up your childish, these childish enthusiasms and stuff. It's just some childishness. And so, look, it's really, really tough. Who are you to think you can do this? So, a lot of the spiritual books actually intimidated me. Didn't need to read them. Didn't really need to read them. It was more of an intimidation factor. I said, I don't need that. I just need the continuity practice. That's all I needed to do. I don't have a freedom problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a suffering problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have any problem except the continuity problem. There is no other problem. The vision of oneness, all these problems have no value, only the vision of oneness has value. That's it, period. That's right, spiritual practice. Keep doing that, you will find clarity just blossoms for you. Just blossoms for you. The breakthroughs are just like a continuous blossoming of breakthroughs is what happens. You just keep your stride. You say, okay, that's what I expect. Of course, that's what I expect. I know these practices work. So of course that I'm going to experience breakthroughs and success. It's not unexpected. Okay, so this is a big pep talk here, big pep talk. What happens in the future? I am not sure. Honestly, I am not sure. Probably at some level I know, we all do. I'm not quite ready to say what it is. Let's put it that way. That's a more honest, truthful way to say it. I'm just not quite ready to tell you exactly what's going to happen. Because maybe it's like people are like, oh my God, you know, I don't know. So at some level we know. At some level we know. And maybe that will come forth at some point. I don't know. Maybe not. Maybe the Holy Spirit says it's best to not talk about it. That's possible too, right? Either way is fine with me. Either way. But of course, I don't have a future problem. I have a continuity problem. Because I'm not a body. I am free. I am as God created me. I relax my mind. I love that moments, past determines the future. That moments are joined. They influence one another. All my thoughts are based on that. All my thinking is based on that. Totally not true. None of it's true. So I release all those thoughts. They're totally useless. They have no value. And what's in the place? An abyss? No. A complete plenum of pure happiness, of untraceable, baseless, vast, process-free, locations-free happiness is there. That's what's there. Doesn't need any thinking or thoughts to make it so, see? Thought independent, thinking independent, happiness. A total, pure plenum of it. Everywhere, 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 everywhere. Okay, again, I'm happy to share this pep talk with the world, and we'll see where it leads us, right? Very interesting path we're on right now. Okay, very great, that's it.